Gamutsanu yenet deyamu kujanai menu. My name's Rainbow Dave, and welcome to another Tolkien history and lore video of the First Age. So, what you just heard there, that was my best attempt at Khuzdul, the language of the dwarves. And that means in this video, we are going to take a break from the history of the elves in Beleriand, that's the firstborn children of Ilúvatar, and instead, we will take a deep dive into the origins of Ilúvatar's adopted children, the fan-favorite race of dwarves. Now, for the most part, I guess broadly speaking, these First Age videos have followed a roughly chronological order. You know, the first one explained, like, the origins of the universe, and we've slowly moved forward in time all the way to the 400-year-long siege of Angband. That's where the previous video left off. But in this video, I am going to have to break that chronology a little bit, because to talk about the origins of the dwarves, we're going to have to go back a long way. Like a really long way, to a primeval time of gods and angels, Valar and Maia. A time before even the first elves awoke. But before I begin the story proper, I'll start out with a little question for you guys to think about. What is the plural of dwarf? Now, some of you, I imagine, will say dwarfs, as in like Snow White and the Seven, and that is actually the standard or technically correct answer. But if you said dwarves, as I myself, and I think most people would, then you have Tolkien to thank for it. Now, obviously, I'm not suggesting that, like, the concept of dwarves was created by Tolkien, you know, a race of subterranean beings who live under mountains and like to craft things are a staple of Germanic and Anglo-Saxon and Norse folklore. In fact, in the historical Old Norse poem, Völuspá, and I'm not confident in my pronunciation there, but in that real-world poem from almost 1,000 years ago, we are introduced to a load of dwarves, and some of them have pretty familiar names, including Thorin, and Thror, and Thrain, and Fili, and Kili, Glóin, Óin, Nóri, Óri, Dóri, Bifa, Bófa, Bomba, and even Gandalf, as well as many more. But what Tolkien did do is popularize the plural of dwarf as dwarves. But what I find really interesting here is that the professor kind of did this by accident. Tolkien himself actually noted that grammatically, dwarves is not correct. I mean, it's true, we pluralize knife as knives, and we pluralize wolf as wolves, and half as halves, but there are a few exceptions to this rule, and among them are roofs, chiefs, and dwarves. And Tolkien was fully aware of this. In fact, he even pointed it out in a letter to his publisher when he wrote, "I am afraid it is just a piece of private bad grammar. Rather shocking in a philologist, but I shall have to go on with it." And so there you go. What started out as simply a spelling error has now permeated through popular culture and become, in many cases, the default. All thanks to Tolkien. Anyway, that's enough of a grammatical tangent so early on. In order to tell the story of the dwarves of Middle-earth, we first have to go back to the Valar, and to one Valar in particular. So in the last video, I talked a bit about Ulamo, didn't I? The Lord of Waters. And in this video, I'm going to talk about a buddy of his, Aule, the Lord of Earth and Rock and Metal. So, if you've seen my first ever video, you'll remember that the planet of Arida was actually first created by Aule and Ulamo and the king of the Valar, Manwë. Ulamo filled the oceans, Manwë made the wind and sky, and Aule forged the fabric of the earth. He built the continents, he built the mountains. And in my mind, I think Aule is one of the most interesting out of all of the Valar. Now, the reason I say this is that with, well, the very obvious exception of Melkor, later known as Morgoth, all of the Valar are pretty unambiguously good. You know, we're actually told that Manwë is so utterly free of evil that he can't even comprehend it. But Aule, he has an edgier side. So if you recall, Aule's main thing is crafting. He created the great lamps that lit the world way back before even Valinor and the Two Trees were a thing. He created the unbreakable chain Anginor that was used to bind Melkor after the war for the sake of the elves, and he even created the vessels that house the sun and the moon. So Aule totally deserves his title of the Great Smith. But this desire to create does lead Aule down a potentially dark path. Now, we are told that most, if not all, of the Valar have disciples, or apprentices, or followers amongst the Maia. For example, Ulamo, the Valar of Waters, has Ossé, the Maia of Coastal Waters, and Uwienen, the Maia of Calm Waters. And Aule has two particularly noteworthy followers too. In fact, we're only ever told of two, and their names are Mairon and Kurumo, both Maia of creation and crafting. Now, I guess neither Mairon nor Kurumo are exactly household names within the Legendarium, but later in the story they both become known by a myriad of other names, most famous among them, Sauron and Saruman. Isn't that interesting? Both of Aule's disciples end up becoming hardcore villains. And I think a significant part of the reason for this is that desire to create. I mean, say what you will about Saruman and Sauron, they're both really good at making things. So's Feanor, and we all know he's not exactly a good guy either. However, right at the core of the Legendarium, one of its most fundamental foundations is the notion that only Eru Ilúvatar can create life. Only he can wield the secret fire. And so, all of these other creators are, and always will be, less than Ilúvatar. Ilúvatar has no equals. And I believe this desire and this envy of the Supreme Creator is part of what leads Melkor, and I guess to a lesser extent Sauron and Saruman, down such dark paths of rebellion. And there is a moment right at the beginning of Middle-earth's history where it looks like Aule might join them. He has a real opportunity to become another Dark Lord, not far off the level of Melkor himself, but he doesn't. Now, interesting as this may be, what on earth does it have to do with dwarves? Well, at some unspecified time after the destruction of the lamps, but before the awakening of the elves, Aule began work crafting the greatest of all his creations. And Tolkien states that so greatly did Aule desire the coming of the children, that's aka elves and men, to have learners to whom he could teach his lore and his crafts, that he was unwilling to await the fulfillment of the designs of Ilúvatar. In other words, Aule was impatient, and he wanted to create a race all of his own. Now, we can kind of, I guess, infer from his actions that Aule perhaps knew that what he was doing wasn't really okay because he wrought his work in secret, and a very, very long way away from the rest of the Valar. Remember, with the sole exception of Ulamo, the Lord of Waters, the rest of the Valar all moved west after the destruction of the Lamps, and they established the blessed realm of Valinor upon the westernmost continent of Aman. And so the eastern continent, that's Middle Earth, was a dark and pretty much lifeless place. I mean, at least lifeless when it comes to, like, good things. You see, the ancient period of darkness is known as the Sleep of Yavanna. And that's because Yavanna, the giver of fruit, the queen of the earth, the sort of goddess of plants and trees and growing things, and also Aule's wife, she laid all the creatures of Middle-earth to sleep, until such a time that light and the spring would come again. And the reason that this is significant is that it was in the dark and sleeping lands of Middle-earth that Aule worked on the creation of his new race. And the sleep of Yavanna is important for another reason. Because the whole point of why she laid the creatures of Middle-earth to sleep in the first place is to protect them from the evil monsters bred by Melkor, that were given free rein to roam the Dark Lands, spreading his corruption and his discord. So, Aule knew that any beings that he created to live in Middle-earth would have to be endowed with some incredible resistance and resilience to the corruption of the Dark Lord. And so, with these traits at the very heart of their being, Aule fashioned the first seven fathers of the dwarves in a hall under the mountains in Middle-earth. And I do think it's worth lingering for a moment on this idea of dwarven endurance, because it's so integral to the fabric of dwarven identity. To survive in Melkor's Middle-earth, Aule created the dwarves stone-hard, resistant to fire, almost entirely unaffected by disease, and incredibly adept at war. In fact, in the 10th chapter of the 12th book in the history of Middle-earth, Tolkien tells us that dwarves are the most redoubtable warriors of all the speaking peoples. By the way, redoubtable, that's just a fancy word for formidable. And on top of all of that, dwarves are also almost impossible to corrupt. I mean, just take a look at the contrast between dwarves and men when it comes to Sauron handing out rings in the Second Age. All nine men were fairly swiftly corrupted into ringwraiths, but there is no dwarven equivalent. Now, it's true that the Seven Rings did definitely have a negative effect on the dwarves. They stoked their greed and their gold lust, but the rings completely failed to turn the dwarves into Sauron's puppets. Ultimately, from Sauron's perspective, they were a bit of a waste of rings of power. But anyway, going back to the very beginning of dwarven history, Aule fashioned the first seven fathers in halls beneath the mountains. But as I said a few moments ago, he cannot create true life. He is not Eru Ilúvatar. And so these first seven dwarves aren't really alive. Or rather, they don't have free will, independent of Aule's. You know, if he wants them to move, they'll move. But if Aule's thought be elsewhere, they'll just stop and stand still. The earliest dwarves cannot live freely absent the will of their creator. In fact, I guess if there's one race that the first seven dwarves could be compared to, it's orcs. Now, obviously, this is a very limited comparison. Orcs and dwarves are very, very different, but both are made by Ainur without the permission of Eru Ilúvatar. However, whereas orcs were made in mockery of Eru's children as a heinous act of rebellion against just authority, the dwarves were made as an act of impatience, but not an act with malicious intent. And right there, that is where we see the fundamental difference between Aule and Melkor. So, although Aule kept his creation a secret from the rest of the Valar, including his own wife at first, it turns out you can't keep secrets from the supreme creator of all things. Eru Ilúvatar knew what Aule was doing, and he knew he was doing it. And we're told that in the very hour that Aule's work was complete, Ilúvatar spoke to him, and Aule heard his voice and was silent. And what Ilúvatar basically says is, why do you attempt this thing that you know is beyond your power and authority? He says basically, your life is a gift from me. Their life isn't real. What was your desire? Which I think is interesting, because it shows that although Eru Ilúvatar is the supreme creator of everything, he's not unlike God with a capital G, he's also a pretty reasonable guy. He doesn't just rip Aule a new one, he gives him a chance to explain his actions. And just before I talk about Aule's response here, I think it's worth flashing back even further to Melkor's response the first time he was called out for his rebellion against Ilúvatar. So back in the very first chapter of the Silmarillion, when Melkor first went rogue, he was filled with shame of which came secret anger. In other words, Melkor doubled down and he refused to demonstrate any kind of humility or contrition. Now compare that to Aule's response. He says, "I did not desire such lordship. I desired things other than I am, to love and to teach them, so that they too might perceive the beauty of Ea. And in my impatience, I have fallen into folly. But what shall I do now so that thou be not angry with me forever? Should I not rather destroy the work of my presumption?" So, in utter contrast to Melkor, Aule humbles himself before Ilúvatar. He admits his folly and he even offers to destroy his creations. And there's a really amazing moment here, because just as Aule raises his hammer to straight up destroy the very first dwarves, they shrink back in fear and they beg for mercy. Now, I guess that may seem like a fairly normal reaction if you're about to be smited by your creator, but it demonstrates something pretty incredible. Because, as I just said a moment ago, the first dwarves can't move or think independently of Aule. And yet, in this moment, they show fear. But it's not Aule's fear. It is their own. At the very moment Aule demonstrates his willingness to submit to Ilúvatar, in the very instance that he proves himself unlike Melkor, Ilúvatar bestows upon the dwarves true life, born from the secret fire, just like elves and just like men. And that is the story of how the race of dwarves entered into the world and became the sort of adopted middle child of Eru Ilúvatar. However, as compassionate as Ilúvatar is, he does still have a plan for the universe, and the dwarves were not originally part of it. Plus, also, he makes a point of not wanting to reward Aule's impatience. So, Ilúvatar decrees that the seven fathers of the dwarves must be laid to sleep beneath the earth, and they must not awaken until after the awakening of the elves, although they also must awaken before the coming of men. And so, with a huge amount of appreciation and thanks, Aule lays the fathers of all future dwarves to rest beneath a series of different mountains all around Middle-earth. And then he returned to Valinor to await the time of their awakening. Now, if you're reading along in the Silmarillion, that's pretty much all we get on the earliest history of the dwarves. Aule lays them to rest beneath Middle-earth, and then some of them just sort of show up in Beleriand 8 chapters later. But of course, this doesn't mean that Tolkien didn't write anything more on early dwarven history. It just means that for the second half of this video, I'm going to have to put down my copy of the Silmarillion and look instead to the Peoples of Middle-earth, as well as Appendix A of The Lord of the Rings. So if we skip forward, I don't know actually, there's a 1917 year margin for error, as Tolkien doesn't give us an exact date for when the dwarves awoke, but take my word for it, at some point within 1917 years of the elves' awakening, the first 13 dwarves awoke. Now, just like the elves, most of the dwarves were laid to rest in pairs, one male, one female, but there is an exception. And unlike the elves, the fathers of the dwarves did not all awaken in the same place. Now, I've mentioned these seven fathers quite a few times, and I guess I should really explain why they are significant to the story. Because, again, just like with elves, there isn't just one clan of dwarves. They aren't all the same. That would be way too straightforward for Tolkien. Instead, there are seven clans, and each one has its own patriarch, its own father, and also presumably its own mother, although dwarf women are very seldom talked about. Anyway, these seven dwarven fathers are laid beneath three different mountain ranges in Middle-earth. In the west, there are the two fathers beneath the Blue Mountains. In the east, there are four fathers beneath the Red Mountains. And in the center, there is one dwarf, laid completely alone beneath the Grey Mountains. or actually beneath just one mountain specifically, that I'll talk about in just a minute. But I'll start with the dwarves of the east, because A, they are the most numerous, and B, they are by far the most mysterious. So, in the barely explored eastern lands of Rûn, you will find the Orokhani, the Red Mountains. And actually, Tolkien doesn't explicitly state that this is where the four Eastern Fathers awoke, but I think it's the safest bet. Anyway, these four fathers, along with their four female partners, became the patriarchs of four Eastern clans, which become known as the Iron Fists, the Stiffbeards, the Blacklocks, and the Stonefoots. And honestly, there's not a whole lot more to say about any of them than that. 4/7 of all the dwarven clans reside in the east, where they just don't interact with the recorded elven histories, and so we know almost nothing about them. And the little that can be gleaned is steeped deep in speculation. So, we're told that the dwarves of the east have their own mansions and their own citadels, not unlike Erebor or Khazad-dûm. And we're also told that in the Third Age, the dwarves of Erebor and Khazad-dûm, by then called Moria, are aided by houses of other fathers, which could very well be a reference to the Eastern Dwarves, but we just don't know. However, we are also told that during the War of the Last Alliance, at the end of the Second Age, there were dwarves who fought on both sides. And seeing how most of Sauron's influence is directed towards the south and the east, it's also very possible to speculate that perhaps some of the eastern clans actually joined the Dark Lord and fought with him against the Last Alliance. But again, we just don't know that. However, we do know an awful lot more about the two clans that awake in the westerly Blue Mountains. These guys are known as the Firebeards and the Broadbeams, and it's these two clans that we will see over and over and over again as we continue with the story of the First Age. The Firebeards and the Broadbeams are the dwarves of Beleriand. They are the ones who helped build Menegroth and Nargothrond. But the truth is, there's a lot to say about them, and I'm actually going to save all of that for the next video, where I will specifically focus on the dwarves of Beleriand. So stay tuned for more info on the Firebeards and the Broadbeams. But by pretty much any definition, there is one clan of dwarves that stands out from all the others. These are the dwarves descended from that one father who was laid to rest alone beneath the Grey Mountains. This clan is called the Longbeards, but they are much better known throughout the Legendarium as Durin's folk. Now, if you're not already familiar with the Silmarillion, then every single dwarf you've ever heard of in Middle-earth is one of Durin's folk, or the dwarves of Khazad-dûm, or the dwarves of Erebor, or the dwarves of the Iron Hills. Every dwarf in The Hobbit and The Lord of the Rings is one of Durin's folk. And it is simply impossible to tell the story of Durin's folk without beginning with Durin himself, the first dwarf ever to awaken. So, Durin the Deathless, as he is known, awoke beneath the holy mountain of Gundabad. And because of this, Gundabad is revered by all dwarves of Middle-earth for the rest of their history. But Durin does not remain in Gundabad for long. He sets off south into the wilds, and eventually he wanders to places that no other incarnate being has ever been to before. It's likely that at this point in the chronology, the elves hadn't even begun their migration to Valinor yet, so Durin the Deathless probably was the very first incarnate being ever to discover central Middle-earth, the part of the map that we are all most familiar with. And so, if we look here, right in the center, we'll find a great lake that Durin the Deathless called Kheled-Zaram, although it later became known as Lake Miromir. And to be honest, Durin the Deathless had a bit of a religious experience when he gazed upon his own reflection within the lake. He saw, obviously, himself, but he also saw the reflection of seven stars forming a crown above his head. And Durin took this vision as a sign. He ventured into the great caves around the lake, and there he began the delving of the greatest dwarven city ever to exist in Middle-earth, Khazad-dûm. Now, it probably goes without saying that Durin the Deathless didn't create all of Khazad-dûm entirely on his own, that would be nuts, but he did recruit a number of wayward dwarves from the other clans, and together they built the great gates of Khazad-dûm, the same ones that the Fellowship exit out of. And in Durin's lifetime, they also built the first hall above the Dimrill Dale and the infamous bridge of Khazad-dûm. And this is another reason why Khazad-dûm is such a significant place to the dwarves of Durin's folk. Not just in the First Age, but all the way into the Fourth Age. It is a tangible connection to the first dwarf. It's a part of their history, it's a part of their mythology, and even their religion. Which makes it all that much more tragic when Khazad-dûm does eventually fall into darkness and become the Black Pit of Moria. So, throughout his lifetime, Durin truly did earn his epithet of the Deathless. Now, we can't be certain about exactly how long he lived, as neither his date of birth nor his date of death are given, but with a little bit of Tolkien maths, we can estimate that he must have lived at the absolute minimum 2,395 years. If we believe that he awoke very shortly after the first elves awoke, and that he didn't die until the very last years of the First Age, which is perfectly in keeping with what Tolkien actually wrote, then Durin could have been as old as 4,312 when he did eventually die. Now, what makes this so utterly amazing is that dwarves are not, of course, immortal. Aule devised them to have longer lifespans than men, but in the peoples of Middle-earth, we're told that by the Third Age, the average lifespan for a dwarf was about 250 years. We're told that Dwalin, you know, one of Thorin's company in The Hobbit, he lives a particularly long life, making it to 340, which is roughly the equivalent of a regular man living to 100. So, you know, rare, but not unheard of. And still nowhere near the length of Durin's life, even at the most conservative estimate. Durin lived and ruled for millennia. He was even more ancient than Khazad-dûm itself. And so, from the perspective of his people, I think we certainly can think of Durin as this almost divine figure. I mean, just imagine being a dwarf of Durin's folk, who's born at some point in the First Age. For the full living memory of your entire race, Durin has ruled. He is all that your ancestors have ever known. And as you grow and live your long life, Durin is still there. And when you're an old dwarf on your deathbed, surrounded by children and grandchildren, Durin is still there, destined to rule for the full length of their lives too. So with that in your mind, now imagine how big of a deal it must have been when Durin the Deathless did eventually die. We're given no specific details, but I don't really think there's any reason to believe his death was violent or unnatural. It seems that the extraordinarily long life that Durin was bestowed simply came to an end, as all mortal lives must. And so, at some point before the end of the Eldar days, before the end of the First Age, Durin's spirit departed Middle-earth, and his body was laid to rest in a tomb within his kingdom of Khazad-dûm. And so, this brings us to a really interesting question. What happens to a dwarf's soul, to their Fëa, when they die? Within the mythology of Tolkien's Legendarium, we know for a fact what happens to elves when they die. Their Fëa is sent to the halls of Mandos, where it's held and judged before potentially being rehoused in Valinor. In the case of men, things are a little bit more mysterious, but effectively we do know the basics. Their Fëa also spends a limited time in the halls of Mandos, and then they're eventually released beyond the circles of the world, where they go to dwell in a place unknown even to the Valar. But dwarves? That's a really good question. And the truth is, no one really knows. We're told that the elves believe that when dwarves die, they returned to the earth and the stone of which they were made. But this is not the dwarven belief. The dwarves believe that Aule the Maker cares for them and gathers them to Mandos in halls set apart, and that he declared to the fathers of old that Ilúvatar will hallow them and give them a place among the children in the end. So, perhaps there is a little section in the halls of Mandos that's exclusively reserved for dwarves. We just don't know. But there is another interesting detail that Tolkien hints at in the Silmarillion. So, within the Legendarium, there is a legend concerning the end of days, the last battle, a sort of Ragnarok-esque apocalyptic event. Actually, it's probably more akin to like the final defeat of Satan in the Christian book of Revelation than it is to the ongoing cycle of Ragnarok. But anyway, this event is most commonly referred to as the Dagorath, the Battle of Battles. It is the end times in Tolkien's Legendarium. But whether this is like an actual thing that happens in the future, or whether it's just a prophecy, or whether it's just something that Tolkien mentioned but then changed his mind about and never intended to be canon, is a matter of fierce debate. And I'm not going to delve into it right at the end of a video all about dwarves. But Tolkien does write that their part shall be to serve Aule and to aid him in the remaking of Arda after the last battle. They say also that the seven fathers of the dwarves return to live again in their own kin and to bear once more their ancient names. So, is it possible that after this Dagorath, some of the dwarves will be reincarnated? It's hard to say. Generally speaking, reincarnation is not something that Tolkien wrote into his Legendarium, but there is one significant exception, and that exception is Durin the Deathless. So, even before you started watching this video, I'm sure most of you had already heard the name Durin. In Fellowship of the Ring, the Fellowship enter Moria through the very well-known Doors of Durin, which Tolkien famously illustrated. And you can actually see here that they're the seven stars above the crown that Durin the Deathless saw when he looked into the Lake Miramir. But even if you've not heard of the Doors of Durin, I reckon you've all heard of Durin's Bane, aka the Balrog. However, the Durins being referred to in the name of the doors and the name of the demon are not the same Durin that I spent this video talking about. Or maybe they are. So, it is said that Durin the Deathless would return to rule Khazad-dûm 6 more times before the days of the Dwarven race are ended. Now, does that mean that Durin the Deathless is like literally reincarnated 6 times after he dies? Or does it mean that he'll have like 6 heirs who are so akin to him in look and spirit that they are named for their original forefather? The answer is very much unclear, but we are told that throughout the ages, Khazad-dûm is ruled by Durin the Second, Durin the Third, Durin the Fourth, Durin the Fifth, and Durin the Sixth. Now, to be honest, there's pretty much nothing to be said about Durins the Second, Fourth, and Fifth, but Durin the Third and Durin the Sixth are both characters worth mentioning. So, Durin the Third, he ruled Khazad-dûm during the Second Age, and he was incredibly close in friendship with his elven neighbour, Celebrimbor, the grandson of Fëanor, the guy who unwittingly helped Sauron forge the Rings of Power. In fact, it's even said that Durin the Third was given one of the 7 Dwarven Rings by Celebrimbor in person, and it is Durin the Third for whom the Doors of Durin were named. Now, the other important Durin is Durin the Sixth, who ruled Khazad-dûm way later, around the middle of the Third Age. And it was right at the end of Durin the Sixth's reign that the Balrog was awoken beneath Moria. Both Durin and his son were slain by it, and thus it is for Durin the Sixth that we get the name Durin's Bane. Now, just before I finish this video, I do want to take a moment to mention the final Durin, Durin the Seventh, also known as Durin the Last. And by the time of the Lord of the Rings, Durin the Seventh has not yet been born, but he is prophesied. In fact, in the peoples of Middle-earth, we are told that Durin the Seventh will be a descendant of Dain Ironfoot, possibly even his grandson. And when Durin the Last does come, he will lead the dwarves back to Khazad-dûm, where they will rule and prosper once more, until the world grew old and the days of Durin's race were ended. So, there you go, guys. That's the origins of the race of dwarves, and a brief introduction to the history of Durin's folk. However, in the next video, we are going to take a look at two very different clans of dwarves, the dwarves of Beleriand, the dwarves of the Silmarillion. And we'll look at all their interactions with Elu Thingol and with the Sons of Feanor. And also, just like how in this video I talked about the creations of Aule, in the next video we'll take a look at the race created by his wife, the Protectors of the Trees, the Shepherds of the Forest, and the sort of step-siblings of the dwarves. So, if you've ever wondered how the Ents first came into being, hit that subscribe button to make sure you don't miss the next video, and leave a like and a comment below if you enjoyed this one. But, as always, until next time, my dear friends, much love. Stay groovy, and Nevaeh Melanine.